Looking forward to it. And over to David. got to the point of organizing Pride agendas myself. Last October, I got a little ping in my inbox, and being a bit of an academic geek, it was a call for papers at a conference in Jamaica called Beyond Homophobia. Now, as you can see, the very shy and retiring Dr. Moji Anderson organized this conference. Please stand up. So we presented, and we thought it would be really useful for us to dialogue with our neighbors about the progress in LGBTQI history and developments. And what we found when we got there, we were astonished. We met these incredible people on this stage here. Particularly coming from the church or churches, and I'm sure these guys will talk about that. And we found that the biggest difference, though, I would say, is that yes, we have had all these legislative changes, but what was lacking, or what we felt was lacking in Bermuda, was civil society organization, academic research, grassroots work. And you will hear from these guys what's been going on in their respective countries of Guyana, Trinidad and Tobago, Jamaica, and Barbados. And they really inspired us because, yeah, we've got there on a journey of earlier with the legislative changes, but these guys will talk about what they've been doing in their countries to advance LGBTQI and the lives of us in those countries. So I don't want to say, take any more time away, because I really want to hand over to Zakiya Johnson-Lord, co-deputy chair of our Bermuda. She is going to be our host for the evening, and I will hand over to you.
I do want to quickly just ask, what made you say yes to us? You know, to the organizers. I know we've heard why they want you all here, but like, what made you find us for any of you to take your time? But what about engaging with other small island nations? Well, that's how I describe it. It makes you want to talk to our people, make you see yourself.
Well, Trinidad and Tobago just hosted Carifest, which is the Caribbean's largest celebration of arts and culture. And Carifest travels across the region every 2 years. But I start there to say that it's only together that we are at our strongest. And interestingly enough, the Caribbean started talking about integration, brother, sisterhood, non-binary, years before the European Union. And as small island developing states, it was important for Trinidad and Tobago to actively reach out and partner with our neighbors, because the synergies we found at beyond homophobia are second to none. So to add support, and not just in writing or in words, but to actually make a decision to show up and provide that level of support and learn firsthand was for us an invitation that we could not refuse.
Thank you. Just to add to that, I was also curious to see Bermuda, because in the Caribbean region, Bermuda isn't often included in those marketing schools. So I was really curious to see what are our similarities and our differences and how we can mesh, and then when you guys started your effort, it just literally blew up, and that was amazing. So like, you know, trailblazing in a way too. And I just think it would be great if we had synergies to really mesh that together. So I was really excited for that.
Thank you so much.
I was about to just add, sorry.
So I think maybe for a minute, like 12 cents are really important for us to take control of the narrative, because so often there is a narrative that is placed on us about what's going on within the region. I think we're so much stronger together as a collective, especially the Amazon program, because we have such similarities in terms of our food and history. So it's just very, very important that the community is forging the narrative, telling our own stories, so that when they reach out and they say that food is having their pride, I'm just like so thrilled. And similar to this, as we said, oftentimes within the Caribbean region, we don't hear a lot about Bermuda. We tend to be a little bit, there's a disconnect there. So we're just really excited that we're even, you know, contacted and such a wonderful people. Thank you.
So, how have colonial era sovereign laws affected expressions about LGBTQI identities in your country?
It's going to be really So in our law, under the Offences Against Persons Act, under Section 76, 77, 79, history of strong policing law in recent years. Studies show that the law is not generally applied, particularly to consent in adults. So in a lot of ways, based on our research, it's been used as a form of policing rape and other sexual offenses, because the Sexual Offenses Act does not provide any protection for men and boys and women and girls. So the way in which we define sexual intercourse in the law is very, very limited, since about vaginal penile, vaginal penetration, and that's it. So therefore, there is just that, which is not consensual. But outside of that, the law creates a culture and environment where LGBT people are often afraid to be who they are, where the law is often used to paralyze people there and cite a back home of Jamaicans to say, your presence, your belonging here is invalid, and that you do not have a right to be here. So while it's not being used necessarily being used by law professionals by the state, it is being used by a number of Jamaicans to police people's expression, to police where people live, and to determine how people should be treated. And consequently, a number of Jamaicans, a significant number of LGBT Jamaicans, do not feel as though they belong in Jamaica, that it is a safe place for them to live, where there is a family and business.
In Barbados, similarly to Jamaica,
you
have the serious indecency act, and in section 912, certain sex acts are criminalized. And oftentimes, we hear from the bugger, you know, we don't think of the fact that it's in the Supreme Court and it's also criminalized. But just like Jamaica, it's not used in the case of consenting adults, it's often used against rape. When an older man has a rape relationship with an underage boy. But in Barbados, we do have very comprehensive sexual assault laws that would cover that. So it's really a useless law. But what it does, in addition to creating an atmosphere of permission for discrimination against LGBT people, let's say, like gays and second class citizens, is it also creates a really dangerous expectation with sexual orientation, particularly homosexuality and sexual deviance. You know, so we had an instance a couple years ago where the Boy Scouts Association, one of the scout leaders, molested a boy, and the head of the scouts came out, prisoners charged with robbery. The head of the association came out and said, we're not going to accept homosexuality in this organization at all, and the second is not homosexuality. So you see that narrative of attitudes being created through society because of the laws that were, you know, instilled through the organization.
Anybody else have thoughts?
Similarly in Guyana, and I think what's important is the complexity of people are still living their lives. However, this will word in the atmosphere. Last year, Georgetown University did an assessment of LGBTQ person effects of the laws in Guyana. They did a countrywide assessment. They said that it basically creates a pervasive atmosphere of policing and fear in both private and public spheres. So,
I want to put a place over at some point. I want to ask a question. I know it's about the law, but I also wonder how complication impacts just the overall behavior outside of the legal sphere. I think for a lot of people ask me, oh, you're from Bermuda, are you also a contract queen? It's a question I don't, right? And I was like, I would not mean it that way. But I certainly have questions asked about the way in which behavior of folks who are in our small island nations have been determined by outside influences, and how that, and as it relates to the LGBT community, like what freedoms are we actually have to take back for ourselves? Because otherwise, we're taught to do this, right? I still walk on the left, because I've always walked on the left, right? Like at a school out here, I didn't know that freedom was mine to take. You know what I mean? Like, and that's nice, and personally, I mean, anybody else may not have that, but a lot of the things that I am just not questioning, I was taught not to question either. You know, and I would say because of the ways in which outside influences have always told me, I need permission from somebody to make some choice about the things that happen. So for me, when I hear about a conversation, I
actually in Trinidad, we have something called the Candle Rites, which we remember each year. It's the beginning, it's what created our carnival. And the Candle Rites were really where many persons from the African descendants who lived in Trinidad, they decided to protest against this ordinance that prevented them from celebrating and use of drums, etc. And that is our history of marginalized, oppressed groups utilizing culture, art, as a form of protest to stand for what they believe are their inalienable rights. So personally, and within our country, we actually see the Pride celebrations as simply an extension of that type of protest. So it's not wanting to have Pride because it's something that happens in the global north or western countries. As a matter of fact, I always make the point that Pride was celebrated for 3 decades, but some describe it as Pride on high because of some of the issues we've touched on, which we'll deal with later on. So it's not new. And the people of the LGBTQI community have always, at different levels, been proud of who they are. And they have made lives for themselves. And some of us that know, for example, the Trinidad and Tobago flag was designed by a gay man. So how much more proud can you get? We don't see it as something that is inherited from a Western world. And we all try to make it local to our experiences and what our community wants. And I think it's well worth sharing a lot of that in your experience.
Yeah, I mean, I think similarly in Jamaica, we get black a lot every year when it comes to Pride because of when we celebrate Pride. So in Jamaica, our week runs from August 1st to 6th, which if you know Jamaican history, you know that that is a very sacred time in Jamaica because that's when we celebrate our emancipation and independence, which is very big for us. And so every year people are always saying, why do you have this entire year? Why are you celebrating Pride? I know that this is our time to celebrate our culture. I know freedom from slavery. And we say to people every year, how do you not see the similarities? Like back in the day when people just wanted to be free, we wanted to feel like citizens of the country. We didn't feel that way. We were enslaved. You know, we were told when to eat, when to go outside, what to wear. We can love, we can have children. And 600 years later, we're doing the same thing. We're still trying to feel like citizens. We still want to wear what we want. We still want to love who we want. We still just want to exist. We just want to live and be Jamaicans, equally like everybody else. So for us, Pride for us is that time of the year. I mean, we read the year. But that specific time period is a time where we say, you are not going to tell me that because I'm LGBT that I can't be Jamaican. You're not going to tell me that because I'm a part of the community that I can do this, I can walk this way, I can go to school here, I can't listen to dance or music, I can't listen to reggae music. No, I'm a Jamaican. I'm just like you. I'm exercising my birthright to love everything that makes me Jamaican. I'm a part of everything that makes us equal in Jamaica. So for us, Pride is not about inside, and we talk about this all the time. We don't even have a parade, because for us, it's about creating spaces that growing up as Jamaicans, we didn't have. I mean, we were in Pride and Bermuda all the time. We have Carnival and parade, so we were in a parade and we keep closed. And if you come to Carnival in Jamaica, that is a time when the gays live it. Because they're out and about everywhere. But Pride for us is really about taking all those spaces that we could not participate in as children. For example, a sports day. If you were a boy that was very effeminate, you could not go cheerleading because that's going to mean that you are homosexual and that's bullying and that comes with everything else. So we say, okay, let us have our sports day.
and put on your cheerleading clothes and go out there and want to walk your way and go flick and relevant. So for us, it's about taking all those fun memories we had as children. And as Jamaicans, that we love and we hold on to so much. And we just make it one big tourist space and say, come, live, exist, and be.
So in Barbados, thank you.
And she shared with me that, and we would not have known this had she not said it, the entire global north, ironically, was seeing what was happening in Jamaica, Guyana, Barbados, Trinidad, and was actually changing their narrative. Because no longer could certain groups hold on and say that pride was for a certain guilt. We have to continue breaking down that narrative that black and brown people are part of the LGBTQI spectrum.
Very important to note too that you don't dictate to us how we celebrate pride, and you can't dictate to us how we should show, you know, being proud and being free. It's not for you to say, if you want to have pride, this is how your pride has to look for it to be qualified as a pride celebration or pride whatever. So I think that is also important to note too, is that people from the global north and from the west, you know, they take to us how we are going to be our celebration pride. And it's for you to decide how you want to celebrate your pride.
I think that's really important to know that when people think of pride as certain type of specific imagery comes to their head, specific types of people, class of people, specific body type, people, specific ability. That is the imagery that comes to mind because that's the image that has been conjured up from a global north point. But it's important to know that with us, this is not, it's not new. We're continuing a legacy of work and pride and celebration that has existed through centuries, not even just decades, but centuries in our countries. Like in Barbados, for example, we used to have a Queen of the Beats show that would sell out in national stadiums, and it was a drag show, and that happened all throughout the 60s and 70s. So this work has been going on. And this is just continuing that legacy. It's nothing new.
What does LGBTQI pride, what the event and the notion of being proud and that, who you are, look like? I think we can touch on it a little bit. I appreciate that. I love the but can you elaborate a bit? What does it look like? While we're not trying to create a piece of art, I'd love to hear a little bit more about, I guess, the visuals and the feel.
We have 53 events this year. One of the reasons that that actually has to happen is because we have to reflect the diversity of our country. Trinidad Tobago is by far perhaps the most diverse of the Caribbean nations. We have every ethnic group, every religion, every difference around the spectrum that is well represented in government. government, in the economy, in business, in social. So our pride has to reflect opportunity. All of our events, except maybe 4 or 5, are free, because we have to reflect the most vulnerable and the access that they require to see themselves in their pride. So we would have events like the sports day, but we also have specific panel discussions. This year we dedicated the pride and trans community, because it was not only Stonewall's 50th, but the trans community also, like New York and elsewhere, they have been on the front lines of this struggle for so long. And we needed to bring the other segments of the community together to show them those similarities and why they need to stand with their trans sisters and brothers. So you see other types of events that we launched our very first LGBT art exhibit, and we got over 50 identified artists, from million-dollar painters to upcoming prisoners. And in that room, you saw every aesthetic, from the Indian diaspora to the African aesthetic to Chinese, and that is what it means to us, that it really is a moment to reflect all that is across the spectrum, and to create spaces that don't normally exist for that reflection. Because I just want to ask you that some of the artists in that exhibition who have sold their paintings for lots of money admitted that certain galleries would not post their work if it was too gay. And that says something. Because imagine you are an established person in your own right and you are still facing discrimination. So that is what the pride must reflect, that continuous struggle for a space where you can truly see yourself and see your identity.
So, I think it's hard to say what the pride reflects, but everybody is different on a personal level. So some people it's taking space, some people it's visibility, celebration, resistance, different things on a personal level. But definitely I agree that on a national level, our pride reflects our culture. So we start with it.
Process for me, and I used to cry all the time because I was like, what do I do? Like, I don't understand. Is it me? Like what is happening? Something is not connecting. And you know, because I was so involved in church, I was like, you know, I'm going to go to church camp and I'm going to pray because I know if I believe God, this will go away. And it just wasn't leaving. And I tried, I had my boyfriend thing, and it just didn't work. And then I had to come to a space in my head where I said, oh no, why can't I just exist at that intersection? Why do I need to act straight in church and then go back and act gay tomorrow and then act, I mean, whatever? Why put yourself through all of that misery? Just exist where you are and just live as you are. And I think it's important to provide that space, a part of Pride Week or a part of your Pride celebration, because you have to include that space, because there are people who need that space to heal from a lot of trauma that they hold on to. And for a lot of them, until it crosses that, they're so like different culture. So for me, Pride is about having very difficult conversations about, like, making the public see us have these difficult conversations, and again, for us to have that narrative over people. So you won't tell us that, oh, because you're gay, like, you can't be in church, and you're going to tell others. All of that is not for you to tell us. Like, we will tell you how we navigate this space. And yes, I think Pride for us, there's lots of different things happening, but I think the main theme that we carry on is a place you have those conversations and how do we move on? Because you have to do that, because it's not the only existing. So we have to, as LGBT people, have these discussions and then see how do we move forward. As a community, this is how we move forward.
Repeatedly
lots of parties. I mean, these days you have even 5 LGBT citizens of party in one given weekend, and you know, some people are running from event to event. So what the Pride did was that it gave us this one group of people that let their hair down and begin to claim into this space who would not otherwise come to LGBT events. And that was what we did. You know, we talked to people about this is why this is important, this is why Pride is so important, because we have to begin to do much more as a community and to show up and to do things. And so the first year was fairly we started with a flash mob anti-emancipation arc. And it was planned for just about 50 people, and they came to the office every evening, rehearsed their routine for the flash mob. And in the morning we had perhaps about 30 to 50 people, some of who knew the routine, others who just turned up because they wanted to be a part of it. And we went, and it was very early to the day, it was a holiday, so not too many people on the road, and they did their thing, and watching have lasted for 5 minutes, 30 minutes of just running around and making statue that caused lots of problems in the past about the screening. And then they came back and it was really rainbow flags, blue rainbow and stuff like that. And I think that really helped a lot of people to understand that it's okay to be rewarded, that we can show up and be much more visible as a people. And I think that's what we can do, helping people understand that. People are going to say that. As a community, we have to understand the value worth of Pride celebration, even if you don't feel comfortable going to one of the events.
So, for Trinidad, we also have our closed job in banks, because we work in banks, obviously. It's important to understand a couple of bits of context. One is, we don't necessarily get a lot of public or overt pushback, homophobic pushback, generally in society. It's mainly certain sections. So a piece of the Islamic spectrum, a piece of the Catholic spectrum. It's not across the board. So from the society, the main criticisms came similar to the, you know, the usual, it's against God and breaking up the family system, etc. They don't want to talk about divorce. But that is very, very, very separate and apart from the real criticisms which actually came from within the LGBTQI community. And sometimes we have to, as community organizers, leaders, whatever we really want to use, we have to own those criticisms. And we have to have the patience and the presence of mind, the emotional mastery to treat with them and manage them. Because they are born out of years of trauma, distrust, and all the other issues we're very familiar with. And they pivoted around it matters that dealt with transparency. Who's making all these decisions? Why 50 events? I can't go to all of them. Where's the money coming from? Who decides which event is free? And the representation. Is Pride really reflecting the diversity that we spoke about earlier? Now, what was important for the committee was that we needed to hear these concerns and have real answers. So from year one to this year, we actually implemented a few things that came directly out of those criticisms. And we noted it. We communicated with the community. You said on your feedback forms or in the assessment meeting that these were some of the matters that you weren't comfortable with, and this is how we are treating with them. So it's just a matter of things that you would normally and reasonably expect to receive. I think the trick is how you respond. And if you don't take the time to respond to it, they can snowball into bigger issues that will overshadow what we are all fighting for. So those were some of the concerns that we got from within the community mainly. But outside of that, people, allies were amazing.
Sometimes it could just end up being, not in the legal officers. We have a separate experience for our buildings. And interestingly enough, because they did that, they got so much press and within all the papers, people then knew that there was a Pride parade happening. And we got like a turnout and came out and support.
Actually, between Jason Jones's case, which was against Tobago, and Pride, the first year, there was the International Day Against Homophobia. And the church, the section of the churches that I refer to earlier, they planned a prayer day in one of our big parks with this prayer. So we thought about, what are we going to do about this? They set up their stage, their chairs, their tents, and we went to garbage bags and started to clean the square. These people were sitting down, praying to heaven, with all this garbage right around them. And the media took that and ran with it for days. Because people were like, what are you praying about? The country needs real help.
Right, like that has really affected the community.
there are so many Black Pride events because the community does not feel as though they are a part of this. They don't feel as though they are a part of this community, right? And it's especially concerning because when more people migrate to these places, they are sidelined even more because then you have to deal with other languages that you didn't grow up in this culture, so you are not one of us fully, right? And it's so sad because we have a huge history as a community of pushing people away, of honoring people, of not allowing people, and that's especially so for the trans community, though they have been in a number of our countries at the front, using their bodies, visualizing the community, standing in the line of fire for many of us, as in men especially, because let's face it, it's the women and trans women who have really led this fight in a number of countries by virtue of just being there and just being bold and courageous. And so, kudos to you.
The feeling of people who are most affected by HIV is people in the Sub-Saharan region and within the
disability disability, and members of the LGBTQI community who are often overlooked. And these issues are often ignored. For example, the trans community. What work have we done in your country to advance trans issues?
So, as I said, this year we dedicated ours to the trans community. But what was important in that was we managed over 50 stakeholders, right? Different NGOs, individuals. We met with the head of the Trans Coalition and Group Committee very early on, and we let them inform what their needs were, because it has to be community driven. And simple things that, again, you sometimes take for granted, is that's what people want sometimes, is a space, a void. And they came out, they launched Pride outside of Parliament with the trans flags and Pride law. The kings came out because Trinidad also has a kingship, which is done by Ireland. And there were kings visiting from different islands as well. And together, for the first time, we saw this representation. And they had to trust us, because in the past, others had promised to stand with them, for them, and help them, and then shy away. And there was a lot of good their distrust. And Randy and everyone else, they took a moment and said, okay, let's try this again. And we were able to provide a platform so that we're not speaking on their behalf. If we're going to meet with the media, if we are having events, you might presume that you can sit here and talk about the issues, but they needed to be with us and seen together, represented. And the other thing that was important was to assist in educating other people in the community. Because again, we don't always understand each other's issues, even though there's some commonality. When people misspoke, or they referred to people in a appropriate manner, or they wanted to ask questions that are offensive, right there and then, we took the moment to have that training and that learning, and say, okay, we hear what you're asking, but this is how you should ask it. And they will explain from their position exactly how those kinds of perceptions make them feel. And we had an entire trans discussion panel with the help of the UK High Commissioner. And that live feed probably got more views than some of the regular events, like just everyday workshops or movie screening. Because for the first time, you had trans people speaking to the entire nation about their issues, what they need, and what help the rest of us to give to them, and saying, I'm here, I'm not going anywhere, and I'm a full equal citizen of Trinidad and Tobago. And that's what we need to do, is give the platform and then kind of step up and let them go with it.
And then we carried it all the way up to the CCJ, the Criminal Court of Justice, which was the highest court, and last year So for one, in Pride, for example, we have a big rainbow flag, which is a couple feet long. And we also have a trans flag. We have lots of trans flags that we also purchase for the celebration in addition to lesbian and bisexual engagement, etc. But outside of Pride, we have ensured that, one, we include transgender persons within our activities as an organization. So at our different events, we use trans persons for panels, etc. One thing we notice at one point is that a lot of ways in transgender persons are included, it's usually poor performance. So we have trans people who are lip-syncing, etc. But then we thought that it's important to begin to help people to understand that transgender people have lots of different talents and that they're able to speak or they're able to say different things and not just to share, you know, negative personal experiences or perform for entertainment. Within the organization, we also have what we call a transforming J-flag policy, which means that we are expected to ensure that there are opportunities created for transgender persons, etc., and that they're treated equally and fairly, and given all the opportunities and values that we given within the organization. And given the circumstances related to the fact that the number of transgender persons who we typically know do not necessarily have the education qualification. And so where there are opportunities where you don't necessarily need 5 degrees, a degree, or some subjects, we provide that opportunity. So for example, one staff member now, we had a little project that we were doing where we could basically just find somebody who we think has talent and potential and who could deliver. And we provided that opportunity to a transgender person. They, you know, performed really, really well and was then given an opportunity to be an assistant in the organization. And so we do that kind of thing. When we have trainings with healthcare workers, for example, we include specific panels about transgender persons and how we relate to them essentially. Ensure that our partners undertake studies and talk to their staff about businesses because we find that for a lot of people it's very new to them and they don't understand all the landmarks, etc. And so it's up to us to begin to help people while we also try and understand much better about the needs and values of transgender persons. And importantly, finally, calling out trans people within the LGBT community, especially among gay men, who I find to be a very, very powerful.
Particularly for the communities that
mentioned sexual orientation. So now that we're working towards trying to advance discrimination legislation and support of that gender identity is included in the intentional and making sure that it is included in the carrying of issues of what we talk about.
Thank you.
To do the mics for hanging around for the Q&A. So if I can have three of you at the front, that would be great. Now do you see why we invited them here? Aren't they fantastic? Okay, so we will open it up to you, and you'll see three of our human rights commissioners coming around with the mics. So feel free to ask for it.
Just before they say the shyness, we actually chose the park that we have pride in Mandela Park because Sasha Fierce was a trans sister who murdered there, and we made one of the events of Sasha Fierce afterwards. And that's a real way that prides can help. We have to remember the fallen ones, so we're going to utilize their names. So we lost Raymond Chupon, who was a theatre producer. We have created a theatre grant in his name. So we're going to continue doing that to keep our people really alive with us. And I think that's a real way that we need to support them.
Good evening.
Hello.
I'm very short, so you have to be nice.
Sorry.
Hi, my name is Linda Bogomont. If literally, if I could come up there and hug and kiss you all. Dialogue that we're having now, you've crossed over racism in this country. So I don't want to ask you, how do you go about healing that fence? I know, Zakiya and I, we talk about intersectionality a lot, but what does it really look like in the Black community? What does it really look like inside of the LGBTQI community? And how did it feature in your push to have better intersectionality in the world?
With great diversity. I mean, Pride is not done by one person in Trinidad. It's done by a core group, yes, maybe about four or five people, and they're all looking on at us. But you have to keep each one of those people at the table. And sometimes it means that you have to put your ego in a box and put it at the table and listen. Because what you said, it's historic traumas. They're not necessarily criticizing or expressing a point of view or attacking you because they don't like you. Maybe that's part of it, but that's okay. It's because they have a real deep-seated challenge that they want to have a voice in their own space. And to keep all of those 50 people at the table, many of them have great egos, they have their own strong personalities, they have issues with insecurities. It takes that patience and that level of acknowledgement that you sometimes have to remove your voice from that table, because your voice has weight, it has privilege, it has strength. And if you keep speaking, theirs is never going to have any weight in the room. And that's how we have it.
In a kind way, I really tried
Because we really need to stick together as a community within the gay community. We need a committee. Love that word when you said it. I want to kiss your big toe when you said it. Talking to you, you know, when you said that, you know, and it's all about transparency. It's all about the people that have come together, stood together, you know, brought this country to where we are. We all have a voice, but we all have to respect each other's opinions, and we have to come together. We have to come together to deal with this. You know what I'm saying? Drag is a very vital part of the gay community. You understand what I'm saying? I'm the queen of Bermuda. I know it. You understand what I'm saying? Still need to be addressed in this country. Everybody has a valid point. Everybody has an opinion. But until you sit down and hear everybody's opinion, we can come together to make this country stronger. But we all have to work together. We have to put aside our jealousy. We have to put aside our vulnerability and all of that type of stuff. And we have to respect each other's space. Thank you, Linda. Thank you, guys. I'm giving you a free ticket to my show tomorrow night.
And it's something that I have tried to, it's not always easy. It's not always easy. Because everybody is seeing the goal, but maybe the journey to get there differently.
Yes.
And all I can say is continue to have compassion and some patience, but to our co-organizers, we need to be more open,
yes,
and responsive, and
yes,
leave the door always open.
Yes.
People can leave, and people can always come back.
Yes.
And that's the takeaway point. Don't lock the door. If people choose to leave because right now they feel away, or they have happened their feelings, no problem. That door must always remain open till the day they want to enter, and somebody have to go outside and say, hey, we need your input on something.
Yes.
You want to come back inside? And they might tell you, no, I won't come, but I'll tell you outside.
Yeah.
And bring you back to the table. And it takes work. But I think we're all showing you that we can really work together.
Together,
so,
yeah.
Thanks for sharing.
We're do this one big happy community. We just sit around a bonfire. We're going to have differences. We're going to have people who think differently, right? But what we must ensure is that during the time of Pride, all those views are put aside and that we understand that the person that we may disagree with all year can have an opportunity to Pride and to be happy and to provide an activity or some sort of support. And that all of us who are not necessarily intimately involved with Pride organizing in our countries have to support the leaders of Pride to grow professionally
yes.
and personally so that the Pride can actually be representative of what all of us want as a community.
Yes, it's just about trying as best as possible from our standpoint and for people because we can have that discussion. It's unfortunate because people reach out to us all the time. You know, they're like, you know, I don't know what's happening, I'm so confused. I just want somebody to talk to. I don't know, unfortunately.
LGBTQ-free equality in the chapter of our organization, which is equal. So they have a unique set, but they're also between the ages of 16 to 22. But also a partnership with people who are connected to youth is really, really important. So we did this year, organization called Dance for Life. There's a huge
LGBTQ+ community, and so a lot of the kids and younger children that are in the LGBTQ Cuba's community get often like ridiculed or mocked or laughed at, and so they live in secret and are afraid. And all this is, I feel, because of the lack of visibility and the lack of communication of the LGBTQ plus community to kids and younger generations.
Time to add. job. Thank you. And thank you again for giving over their time and brought us together. Chad, you
First of all, I want to compliment the organizers of the event. Let's give them a hand for them.
Stop. Chinese little things, it's even like a social media campaign. It's very small, but it put a issue out there. And I realized in Jamaica, people don't know anything about our LGBT issue. And we have such a big issue. We have, from, I think it's in the 1960s or 70s, and I remember that there was this old, there was this man that he was one of our founding fathers at JFL, and he migrated.
Thank you. just to reiterate what Liz mentioned, part of honoring our history and those women for us, we are honoring who come in tomorrow. So if you have not picked up the tribute that has been lovingly prepared by Liz, please do so. It will be at the back of the room. That will give you a sense of part of the reason why we've chosen to honor him in his time tomorrow. That's all I want to say. Thank you. Happy Pride. See you early tomorrow.